And I think that will create some of the safety hazards you're trying to get away from. I think there might be alternatives. A very wise woman talked about a one-way thing. I'm not sure that's the answer, but conceptually, something like that, or something like taking the center line strip off of Shore Road and making, keeping the width the same and coming in 4 feet and painting bike paths and making it more difficult for traffic to come by. By the way, that wise lady that talked about the one-way system, right next to her, there was a wise man. And he said something about the liability. And I would caution that whatever the design is or isn't, it should be done properly. This is a quote from the PACS people that put the bikeways together. It says, please note, a liability risk may be created by erecting bicycle signage on roadways that have hazards to bicycle travel. Bicycle signage may attract cyclists to a particular roadway. Therefore, it is incumbent upon a municipality to make sure this road can adequately accommodate them. And so I'm really am mixed on this. I want to encourage, I live on Shore Road. I have a young daughter. I'd like to encourage walking. I'd like to encourage bicycling. But at the same time, I'd like to discourage traffic. And I think that's, if this study will start to look at those, we'll start to look at complying with the comprehensive plan that this town approved, that talked a lot about the rural character. If all those things could happen, if alternatives, whether it's bikeways in the green belt area, or, by the way, I might add, living on Shore Road, I see a lot more people trying to walk than I do trying to bike. And the design for pedestrians might be different than design for high-speed bicycles. So I think if there's an openness to look at ways of saving money by being more creative in how we do this, if there's an openness to adhering to the comprehensive plan that talks about the rural character is really important, if there's truly an openness to study this and look at this and then come back to another public hearing where we'll have, we can give you our input on the final design, then I'm in favor of it. If it isn't, if this is just widening of the shoulders, I have a lot of fears, and I would be very much against it. Thank you.
Okay, I was asked to sit in for a moment for the chairman. I believe we came from this side, so is there anyone up here? You next.
I'm Sarah McCall, and I live at 4 Avon Road in Shore Acres. I'm really speaking from a broader perspective of healthy futures. In December, the announcement was made that the Greater Portland community has a lot of lifestyle issues that it should look at. And we are more likely to be overweight, more likely to binge drink, and more likely to engage in unsafe behaviors. And obviously all of us here in Cape Elizabeth share that because we drive on Shore Road. I'd like to ask, respectfully submit to the council that I too am in favor, just as Harold Page just kind of started us off with, at looking at the broad context of what we're trying to do in our community. There are scores of communities throughout the United States and throughout the world who are taking opportunities to look at how to build a healthier community. There is a great deal of evidence that people lack confidence in their leaders, that they feel their sense of community is diminishing, and that they are very concerned about the health of their community. What this spells is an opportunity for us, because suddenly somebody is offering money, and it's an opportunity for us to think about whether spending money to make a specific road safer actually serves the public safety, a sense of community, and perhaps would increase our faith in our leadership and our own sense of each other. I am in favor of studying the issue. I came here very clearly in favor of the bike path on Shore Road and perhaps on Two Lights Road. I have a mother who lives here on a fixed income. I've been hit by a car on 77, thrown to the roof of a car. I'm much better for it because I don't ride on Shore Road. I have a lot of perspective, and I'd like to hear more and discuss more about the opportunity to consider building the bike path. Thanks very much.
Be this section over here next. I believe the gentleman way back on the left. You, sir.
No.
Yes, you.
Thank you. I'll be brief. My name is Fred Joshua. I live at 85A McKinney Point Road. For those of you who don't know where that is, it's a little dirt road that's right off of Park Road near the entrance to Two Lights State Park. And one thing we haven't mentioned is we have some really great parks here. And I grew up in Ohio where the idea of a park is kind of a field. And the ones we have here are not like that. I think it would be a shame not to take advantage of the opportunity to connect those parks in a way other than on a motorized traffic. The other thing I'd like to say is on Two Lights Road, it is very straight. It is very clear once you get to the area that the people earlier had been discussing. Before you get to that, there's a between Pheasanton Road and the entrance to the park, there are some hills that are extremely dangerous. There's no visibility. When you're going up over those hills, you can come right on to pedestrians, not know they're there. So that portion of the road is very dangerous. Final thing I'd like to say is, looking back 20 years from now, I think the council here will be remembered in a very positive light if we do proceed with the bike path. Thank you.
Thank you. Gentleman in the white sweater way back, sweatshirt.
Yes, good evening. My name is Pierre Hansen. And although I do live in Portland, I'm representing my mother, Jean Hansen, tonight, who lives at 3 Two Lights Road. And she's been there for 15 years. She couldn't be here tonight, and so I'm speaking on her behalf. I think we both share the same opinion, although being here tonight has been very enlightening to hear both sides of everyone that has spoken so far. I'm learning a lot about different options we might have about this bike path. From where my mother lives, she's right at the coming off 77, right on Two Lights Road. She's the first house on the right that particularly close to the road, and has being from Portland, I come out to the Cape to enjoy it. I feel it's a very special place, if not in that particular part of the Cape, very magical, if I may say that. With all due respect to the people that ride bikes and pedestrians, which I've seen quite a few walking around that corner, which is very dangerous. I have a lot of sympathy for them. I also have witnessed quite a few accidents around that corner with cars that, if it weren't for the trees and the shrubs that surround my mother's yard, they would be literally in our house. There's been a number of cars that have just been totaled. Most of the cars that come around that corner and don't make it, the only thing keeping them from driving up into the yard is the shrubs and the big oak trees that we have, like three very large trees. I think that one of the big problems concerning that stretch of road around that corner is the speed. I've come down to talk with the chief about lowering the speed limit down there, and he tells me that the Department of Transportation says 35 miles an hour is a safe speed for that corner. I dispute that, because anyone who comes off of 77 heading down towards Two Lights can actually almost accelerate, depending on the kind of car you have. And I've witnessed very, you know, quite a few people speeding around there, which I've tried to encourage a radar or a police officer waiting down in that area to maybe dissuade people from driving fast. I feel that it is an historical part of the Cape, and it, again, I'll say it's nothing short of magical for me, because I just appreciate it that way. My mother's house is very close to the road, and if the bike path were put in, it would bring her that much closer. And if the trees or the shrubs were removed, it would place her in danger. I mean, not forgetting about the pedestrians and the people that want to ride bikes. I've been enlightened since I've been here listening to some of the speakers. I think that this is a chance to improve the safety, but I think you also have to think about something that the Cape is known for, is historically speaking. I've only been here 15 years, but I have a great appreciation for what the Cape, I think what it stands for, and I think that also depends on where you live. And if you have children, or if you like to ride bikes, or if you're a jogger, I mean, it all depends. So I would say to be very careful on approving this. And I would be opened, I would like to hear more about maybe the other options aside from widening the road. On Two Lights Road I can speak, but on Shore Road I don't really, I don't have too much information. I can't speak about that road. But I know it's just as beautiful. I've driven out of my way to go Two Lights Road many times. I know it's dangerous. But if I think the main thing is, if we could get cars to slow down, that it might be safer for everyone, whether you're in a car or on a bike or in a house. Because if my mother was here tonight, I'm sure she would be very concerned about her own safety in her own house.
Excuse me. How much more you got? I think you've got your 5 minutes.
Okay, that's fine.
Okay?
Yes.
Hi. Thank you. Yes. Charlie. Excuse me. What I would like to say, I mean, I appreciate everything you have to say, but get up there and try to hit your high points on which way you're going to go, because there's quite a few people I would like to speak, and it's 10:15, and I think they're getting restless, and I heard today that they're going to wear the council out with the town hall. It's going to be standing room only, but I'm still raring to go if you want to go, but I think some of these other people here, as I got a note, they've got to work tomorrow, and they would like to get an indication here. So anybody going to have a chance to speak? But if you can possibly can, cut it back. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, Julian Coles, 15 Roundabout Lane. And I appreciate your wanting to get this hearing over, but I also appreciate the opportunity to say a couple of things. To me, it's three things that I look at that, and I am in favor of the bike paths. The timing of them, it is clear that as a country, we are going to be putting more emphasis on alternative modes of transportation other than the car. And we have an historic opportunity in this town to take advantage of new money coming from the federal government to encourage towns and communities to look at alternatives. They're not cheap, and they probably won't get done without some priming of the pump. And I think that, as one gentleman said earlier, we as a town have every right to expect some of the tax dollars to come back to this town. God knows there aren't many that do. Second is the issue of safety, and I'm not going to say anything more about that. Everybody seems to have covered that, although I am a biker and not the typical biker, and I think there are many like me that have got on a bike in the last 4 or 5 years and found it enjoyable, although I would tell you somewhat
It's disconcerting to drive on or to ride your bike on Shore Road, and it is a road that attracts you to it because of its beauty, and therefore leaving a bike path off that road will not leave bikers off that road. But the third thing is, so it's timing, safety, and the third thing is vision. You as a town council have an opportunity to exercise leadership and to show the future people of Cape Elizabeth that you have the vision here tonight to start the process to move forward with a bike path that is done with the right aesthetics and the right amount of design work, which I'm sure can be accomplished. You have a chance to connect two parts of the town. I come from the part of town that is not well connected to the Oakhurst area, and this road, certainly a bike path, would help me get where I would like to go to other parts of the Cape. So you have a chance to connect the town, to make us more connected as citizens, and to show the people of this community 15 and 20 years from now that you had the vision to create a more livable community than we have before the bike paths are built. Thank you.
Cool. Gentleman right in the front, you'll be next.
Members of the council, taxpayers. At three different occasions, I've spoken to the councils.
Give your name and address, please.
My name is Arnold Sanborn, taxpayer, Hermith Rush Road. The first was done up when they wanted to turn Fort Williams into a fish factory by the government. This is true. You were going to get a path down to the lighthouse and back. And the other occasion was a school matter. Okay. Now, I do not want to pay more taxes. So there's only one way to do it, and that is to pay our way. I tried and attempted today to find out how many bicycles were registered in the town of Cape Elizabeth. This information apparently is not available. It's a little bit jumbled up or something. So I said, well, why don't we take the people who want to ride the roads, and we will let them pay for the privilege, and the people who don't use it, they won't have to pay somebody else's way, which is seems to be the way that it should be from now on. Government-wide, no, because the old saying, you don't look a gift horse in the mouth. You don't take their 80% when the gift horse is a real tired, sick nag, and the vet bill is damn big. I hear a lot, I've heard a lot about safety, and I agree 100%. But I'm sure the minute that you take the bicycles off from Shore Road, that the people are going to feel they have no longer a responsibility of bicycle riders so they can go. Do you realize that a bike path on the side of the road is just as dangerous, practically, as a bicycle in the road? If they go off the road, they're going to hit a bicycle. So now we're going to have to plant trees or something to protect the bike riders from the automobiles instead of the other way around. Whatever. All right. Now, the other thing is, are we looking for people to ride bikes, or are we trying to show the biker scenery? Why do we pick the two most traveled roads in the town to use to put bicycles on? You know, you think about it. Normally, you take a bike path and you put it out in the woods, a path or a place to go. I can remember, and I hate to date myself like this, when I rode on open-air trolleys right out here, right to Town Hall. It's as far as we went. From here, we walked to Crescent Beach or whatever. But there was a path for electric cars that was wide enough the whole length of Ocean House Road. Why can't we put a bike path, a jog path, or whatever you want, and put it right down Ocean House Road? That's plenty of room to ride, longer than what we want, because maybe it isn't quite as scenic for the riders. But it could make a beautiful path, and there's room galore, and be very inexpensive. I think in the essence of time, they have a saying that if you want to be seen, you stand up. If you want to be heard, you speak up. But if you want to be appreciated, shut up.
Mrs. Hayward.
Uh, My name is Fran Haywood, 1221 Shore Road. I can't imagine a harder act to follow. Very much appreciated and enjoyed remarks. A couple of things. The beauty issue, I would only say very briefly, when you have something that is beautiful, treasure it, try to preserve it. Lord knows all of us have had to, sadly, get used to a lot more ugliness in our lives, on the TV, in the world, everywhere else that you turn. When you have a chance to preserve beauty, leap at the opportunity. The safety issue, those people, those parents who were up here and in my opinion, very wisely said that they do not allow their children to bike on Shore Road, I say good for them. That's good sense, because it is not a safe place for children to bike, and it won't be a safe place for children to bike when there's a 4-foot path on either side of the road. A child hits an acorn, a child hits whatever it is that David Wing hit, a child hits whatever it was the young lady who spoke about going on the roof of a car hits. Where does a child land? In the road, under the wheels of a car. For as far as I'm concerned, for this town to invite bikers, younger age bikers, less experienced bikers than use the road now, is just inviting disaster. Rollerbladers included, there will be many, many more of them. I have never had the dubious pleasure of seeing a rollerblader on the Shore Road. I can't imagine a more dangerous combination than a rollerblader in those curves, bike path or no, and a car coming around. The money that has been allocated for it, even though it's $500,000, which I think all of us would recognize is a huge amount of money, I think any of us in this room who have had any landscaping, any stonework done, any paving work done, will recognize that it's very doubtful that this project could be done for anything close to $500,000. My friend and not too distant neighbor anyway, John Mitchell, I understand is very in favor of a bike path, but it's a little hard for me to imagine that eyeballing it, that you can use that information and throw away the information from the 3 or 4 engineering studies that have been done on, in fact, what impact it would have. I think it would have a major impact on many more than 6 trees. You just take a tape measure to it, I think that would pretty much tell the story, a lot more than just a few feet of stone walls, a lot of things which we, many of us, treasure along the whole distance of the Shore Road. One of the important parts of this discussion for me is something that I think is a little bit indelicate to talk about in Cape Elizabeth, and that is the kind of town that we are becoming. It seems to me that more and more, you see it in the schools, you see it in the neighborhoods, you see it around town. More and more, I think we are becoming a town where there are the have a lot of money and the struggling, and very, very few and getting fewer in between. I think the cumulative effect of these very, very many and lavish projects that we have funded over the past several years has been really oppressive on many, many of the people in this town. The Shore Road neighborhood, the very majestic houses at one end through the other end where there is a little bit some more modest houses in the meantime, and then getting to some of the higher income houses toward this end of the Shore Road and near Old Colony. In lots of neighborhoods in this town, you know where they are. We all know where they are. There are people who have very low incomes and who have, and in some other areas, people who have bought their homes 15 and 20 years ago, long before the boom times of property value skyrocketing. Those people's incomes don't match what the value of their houses is even at this time. And I really think that this council really needs very, very much to look at the kind of town that we are becoming. I don't want my children to be growing up in a town, to be living in a town where there can be so little diversity because of the economic realities of having to come up with a very large income to support life in this town. They're not going to be living in a world like this. I think we should try to create for them a world that is a little bit more diverse than it is able to be now. One of the last things, actually, that I want to talk about is the common good. It always seems to me that in any project that has the label the common good, there always seems to be some bad. And I must say that through the years, and it's happened many times, the people that seem to be in favor of the common good never seem to be the same people that will be suffering the bad. And I think that we have to start thinking a little bit more sensitively, a little bit more kindly toward people. Several people have mentioned their particular difficulties with their own homes and homes of relatives on the Two Lights Road. I'm one of the people who looks at the Two Lights Road and thinks, gee, I think there's huge, terrific visibility here. I don't understand why we need to add more tar when cars and people can, you know, see each other very, very well for very long distances. And the very last point, I have just one more point to make.
Okay.
I think that it would be very unlikely that this project could be done without the taking of some people's land, some portions of some people's land. I think that this is something that the government reserves to itself when there is no, absolutely no alternatives possible, and when the public interest is so great, so compelling, so necessary, that the most basic American right of property ownership must be compromised. Councilors, I would have to just tell you, this does not even come close to those kind of criteria. This, as far as I'm concerned, is just one more expensive toy in the already lavishly appointed playground of Cape Elizabeth. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, lady with the red plaid shirt, Judy.
Good evening. I'm Judy Lardner on Avon Road. I first want to say that, is this the so-called iced tea money we're talking about? I really support that. It's long overdue. Our federal government has funded cars for too long, and these monies are really important. However, I'm really disturbed that the discussion has been really couched in the terms of pretty much Shore Road as is, or a bike lane which has to be 4 foot paved on both shoulders. I think I've heard three people say, where are the alternatives? I'm strongly in favor of planning. I'm strongly in favor of spending small monies now if it gets us large benefits, but I don't know where the planning has been here. One man, I don't know if it was in jest, I hope not, because I would have said the same thing, is have we looked at what we can do with moving the stripes? That gives you room on the shoulders automatically. It gives the perception to people that the road is a little more unsafe and you slow down. If you widen roadways, time and time again, this has been historically what happens in road planning, is you widen it, cars go faster. So the engineers widen it some more, they give the curves a little more, and they go faster still, and they wonder why children get hit. Now, I would propose that we do several things. One, what is the deadline for accepting or declining this grant? I haven't heard that mentioned. Or is there one?
PACS has indicated they'd like to know this month. Obviously, you know, it's not a hard and fast deadline.
What I think we might do first, since I don't know how much citizen involvement there has been, is if we have to put a quick ad hoc committee together to look at maybe a handful of alternatives. I think a lot of people in town personally would get a lot more use of a sidewalk on one side of the roadway with a lot less visual impact. So if you get a handful of people, and we have a tremendous amount of talent in this community, I'm sure that would volunteer to do this, is to come up with a list of, you know, moving the stripes, adding a sidewalk, what have you, all the alternatives. Those iced tea monies, I think, are for pedestrians too, so it's quite likely we could keep that grant money for a sidewalk on Shore Road. So if we could explore this, then come to the council and say, here are five alternatives, let's narrow it down. I'd hate to see you authorize money for a study with the implicit notion that it's for a bike path, because that's what we're going to pay our money for, and we're going to get some proposals about what trees to move and what trees not to move and so on, and we wouldn't have explored any of these alternatives. So I strongly urge the council to know what the possibilities are and not look at it as an unsafe shore road or 4 foot paved sidewalk or paved pathways. And finally, people talk about pedestrians, but I, for one, would not want to be on Shore Road. With 8 feet of pavement would make cars go faster, but 4 feet of pavement is awfully frightening to be walking across speeding automobiles. So I don't think that helps the pedestrian much. Thank you.
Gentleman, right in the, yes, right here, go ahead. Don't quite get your color of your shirt.
I'm Dick Wigton. I live on Hunt Club Road. I'm a biker. I'm a fiscal conservative. I will not be redundant with many of the comments already made here. I am a strong proponent of the bike path. I would like to make one comment about the safety issue and speed. I don't believe the cars will go faster on Shore Road when we put a bike path on it. I think all you have to do, if you haven't done so, is drive out Black Point Road into Prout's Neck, which is a straight road going in, and look at the speed of the cars going in that road. It's a 25 mile an hour speed limit, and the cars are generally going 25 miles an hour. Why? Because you have a speed limit and it's enforced. All we have to do is enforce the speed limit, put police cars periodically on the side of the road, and people will get the message. Thank you.
Joel.
My name is Joel Russ. I live at 28 Rocky Hill Road in the Oakhurst area. Mr. Chairman, you have a lot of patience, and I appreciate the opportunity you've given everybody to speak. It's obvious that a lot has been said tonight, and I'm not going to be guilty of too much repetition, I hope. I've lived in Cape Elizabeth for 47 years. My folks moved into Elizabeth Park in 1948. My wife is a school teacher in Cape Elizabeth, has been for 15 years, and one of the highlights of her day is to drive to and from the Cape Middle School from our home. So we both enjoy the character of this community and that particular drive as much as anybody who's had the opportunity to experience it. I'm also, as some of you know, an occasional jogger along Shore Road, and so I understand some of the safety issues associated with the use of that road. It's the most offensive running I do. One of the earliest speakers suggested that he often shifts sides of the road in order to avoid some of the more dangerous curves, and I can sympathize with that need. I think Tom Emery captured a lot of the sentiments from many of the speakers here tonight, and that is an attempt to, we hope, seek an appropriate and responsible balance between access and safety and the maintenance of the character of this important road. I was one of the several hundred people who signed the petition either yesterday or Saturday. And I don't sign petitions lightly. I signed it because I thought it was a thoughtful, responsible approach to a complicated issue. I'm one who feels very strongly about the value of maximum citizen participation in a political process. I also have a great deal of confidence in the choices that citizens who care deeply about their community will make. It's clear to me tonight that the sentiment expressed by all of the speakers is one of a community that cares deeply. I hope you'll approve the application for this grant, form the citizen committee that has been suggested. If you're looking for volunteers, I'd be more than happy to participate, and I believe that the citizens of this town will make the right choice about Shore Road. Thank you.
The gentleman in the white shirt way back. Maybe that isn't white, but I thought it looked white from here.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My name is Chris Kinney, and I live at 42 Longfellow Drive. I'm one of the people who does represent diversity in this community. And I'm also a cyclist, and I also have a daughter who just this past year was an alternate on the U.S. team. I hope we'll be a national person next year. So between the two of us, we put in, I only a fraction of hers, but let me say, We put in thousands of miles. My daughter will probably have in probably 3,000 to 4,000 before probably April 15th. But I'm also a person who's seen my taxes rise by in excess of 25%. And that's been in 2 years. And I did hear the comment that this would cost approximately $1.80 per person, and that the school, if that's $18 million, I figured it would be $36, but I heard $30. I would just soon pay $40 and call it even for all two, but I really don't believe that that will be the true cost. And what I want us to think about here is, first of all, that the road going down to Two Lights, that road is only 1 mile long. It's fairly straight, most of it. For that amount of money, how many people are going to benefit from it? Is a person going to drive there, park the car in the road or at the dairy joint, ride 1 mile down, 1 mile back? I really don't get it. Second of all, with Shore Drive, I and my daughter use that road quite frequently. It is safer than some roads because it is windy, because the people in the area are accustomed to cyclists on the road, and in one manner it is a safer road than other roads. In another sense, it is very blind and is dangerous, and I'm concerned about the character. To wrap this up, because we want to do this very fast, is one, my taxes have risen 27% 2 years. It's putting a strangle on me. So if the school only costs that amount of money, I got to come back here tomorrow and see what happened. Two, Two Lights, I don't think needs to be built. It's 1 mile. It's a 2 mile bike ride. What about the other 100 or so miles in this town? And two, I think we need to think of the alternatives for the Shore Road, because I'd hate to see it lose its character. I'm an underemployed professional, and I'd like to stay in this community, but I'd also like to see it better. So I think we ought to think of alternatives that we can utilize as well. And I'll also volunteer to be part of any committee which would like to make the road safer. And lastly, what can we do to improve cycling safety in this community right off without doing very much? Look at the railings right there. See the white railings? If you have a drain cover that's on the side of a road and it faces going along with the traffic, then when a bike wheel falls in it, you're going to maim someone. We have those in this community today. It's very easy when the drains are next cleaned to put those so they face the, toward the curb, and then that takes out the danger. Two, when the roads are safe from the snow gone, the roads, if they're swept, that takes away the sand. That's dangerous to cyclists and motorcyclists. And number three is when there's a hole in the road, we patch it. Those are quick remedies that we do all of those now except for the drains. So thank you very much for your time.
Yes. Lady there with the blonde hair. That's the best I can do.
I'll be brief. I'm Susan Mitchell, Smugglers Cove Road. I think we've all discussed the problems that exist on Shore Road tonight, and I hope you'll be motivated to do something about these problems. But we have to face reality. The bikers, the joggers, the pedestrians, the cars, they're there. They're there now. We have to provide some kind of a shoulder for people to get off the road. I've lived in this town over 20 years, and I walk the road almost daily. And I can't tell you the number of close calls that I've had. There's no way that two cars and a pedestrian can be abreast on that road at the same time without one of them going off the road. And I think that we've got to face and give ourselves a reality check. Shore Road needs to have some shoulder. I know that town ordinances now people must provide either a curb or a sidewalk or a shoulder. And I'd like Shore Road to, when we're getting help for this, to enjoy that same measure of safety that we require new roads in this town to have. In the summer months and in the fall, the tour buses that come down Shore Road are so numerous you couldn't count them in a day. They go from Fort Williams to Two Lights to Crescent Beach, and it's constant and it's ongoing. And sometimes I think that the tourists that come through our town enjoy Shore Road more than we do. And this is like an arterial that connects Fort Williams to the two state parks. And I think we need to recognize the traffic. This is a heavily traveled road, especially in the summer and fall months. People you see out there now using Shore Road are the people that dare to be out there. You don't see the people that want to use Shore Road. Many people would like to walk on that road. They'd like to go to the center. They'd like to walk to the fort. They're afraid to do that. All we need is a 4-foot shoulder so that you can get off the road, so that you can find that just measure of safety that convinces you that it will be a pleasant walk if you can just have that place to get off the road when two cars pass. So this is reality. This is happening already. We're not encouraging more. They're already there. And then in closing, I'd just like to say, many years ago, this town gave prime pieces of oceanfront property to state parks and to parks. We invited tourists and people from afar to come into our town. We invited them to come, and they come by the thousands, and they use Shore Road as their connector link. And I think it's time that we've got the opportunity, we're getting a wonderful 80% grant, it's time that we provide the safety for the residents of this town who would like to use this road too. Thank you.
The gentleman right there with the blue shirt.
Oh,
the best I can do.
It's fine. My name's Thomas Egan. I live at 41 Hannaford Cove Road. I, too, will not speak again over and over and over again about the safety problems on Two Lights Road or the difficulties with the quality of life if the road is widened. But I want to underscore how important I feel it is for the town to go forward at least with a study of the feasibility of a bike path on Two Lights Road. If we do not study the issue, we'll never know whether we could protect life and limb on that road at an environmental or quality of life cost that is acceptable to the entire neighborhood. And so for that reason, I hope you'll cast your vote in favor of a study for a bike path on Two Lights. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, Penny.
My name is Penny Carson, and I live on Trundy Road in Shore Acres. I just want to tell the council, having spent 3 terms in the council, this is, I think, the second time I've been back, so this is a biggie. But we've never seen this many people here, I don't think, since we talked sewers, and we talked those for 9 years, so. During the course of that time on the council, as you sit here on the council, there have been opportunities to take federal monies or not take federal monies. That becomes something that you need to think about. Maybe all of you are thinking about that in some way. I understand, because I'm a latecomer to the discussion here, that there are 4 councilors who do not support doing something on a pedestrian way. I don't know exactly which councilors they are, but I have tried to find out what reasons they have for not supporting it, and I've been unable to do that, so I hope if they're out there, they'll tell us which ones they are. During my time, I did some things, and you know, I look back on my votes, and there's a few of them that concern dollars. For one of them is, I fought desperately not to accept Rachel Carson to caretake our marshes. In hindsight, probably not too swift. It might have been better to keep it with Rachel Carson at the time. I went door to door on Route 77 and asked every single person in every single house if they wanted us to put bike paths on Route 77. And there were trees to come down, corners to be taken out, roads to be straightened. I thought we were putting in the turnpike. I voted against that. Probably it's better. I've never heard any problems from any of those people since then. There's no cars in their living rooms. There's no telephone poles in their kitchens. I voted against it. But I probably should have voted for it. On the other hand, I worked very hard to keep Sawyer Road from losing its rural character in not having 8-foot bike paths. I feel quite good about that my struggle is I think we have 5-foot paths on that, or sides on that road, whatever it is. So there are votes you take that you feel good about and votes that you don't feel good about, and I've certainly had my share. I suspect the trees that were taken down at Family Field may well have been planted by my mother, a trustee of that field. And so there are changes that take place, some you like, some you don't like. But you want to look back on some things. As counselors, what you need to do, what we all want to have happen, is that you look out for us. We're the citizens. We elect you. You look out for us. You look out for all of us, our entire spectrum of ages, from birth to death. We have $11 million here, I understand. That takes care of us from 5 to 18. Well, I'll have a few more years left than that, and we're all going to pay for it. Across the board, evenly, fixed incomes, not fixed incomes, we're going to pay for the children between the ages of 5 and 18 years old. A path on Shore Road is not for the children. It is for everybody. It is for all ages. What do we have in this town that satisfies all ages? We have the pool. And we fought hard for the community services program because it met the needs of all the citizens in our town, not just the children, and we were able to use that facility. I'm not sure if senior citizens have to pay to use the pool. I hope not, but maybe they do. But here we have an opportunity to do. Is that right, Nancy?
Yeah, but
well, we get a discount if you're a senior citizen. I have to say, the former Councillor Amaro, who planned to be here but was ill, former Councillor Masterson and I have not been here before, but we stand united for the bike path. I hope that you'll consider in your votes that people have, I'm not going to speak about the financing of it. We have an opportunity to provide something for all the citizens. The question of this linkage between the north end and the south end has value. We have the north and south in Maine, and we've had the north and south in Cape Elizabeth through 9 years of sewer discussion. I know that. This is a linkage. This is the fort. The fort is ours. It is not Crescent Beach. It is not Two Lights. It is ours. I venture to say on my bike, when I get on my bike in the morning, I go around the loop on Route 77. A nice ride. I don't go anywhere. I come right back to my house, but it's a nice ride. And I feel fairly safe about it. But to be able to say, gee, I think I'll ride over to the fort, a destination. I can ride my bike and I can go to the fort and I can do it safely. I think that has an advantage. I don't have any kids in the high school. I pay my taxes. And if it's 80 cents, I want my 80 cents to go for a bike path. So I hope you consider all of us. Thank you.
Thank you. Gentleman back here, yes. We better turn this way.
I know.
Council Chairman, Councilors, ladies and gentlemen. Before I came here tonight, my name is Frank Potenzo. I'm at Ivy Road, that's Cape Cottage Woods. That's a big area up behind St. Albans Church. I had some precise thoughts tonight, clear, concise, and now after almost 3 hours, I'm feeling kind of muddled. I think there's a lot of confusion here tonight. One gentleman said we have 2,000 homes in Cape. Someone whispered to me that we have 6,800. Today's paper about the sewer thing said we had 8,000 homes in Cape Elizabeth residents. Okay. Councilor McGovern made some comments as to the consequences of widening Shore Road and Two Lights Road. The people in this room are the only ones that heard and made the statements, and it's the first time I've heard. Does anyone really know, when the federal government mandates money to you, what their requirements are? Is it going to be 6 feet wide on each side, 4 feet wide on each side, 10 feet side on each side, or what? And all the conversations here tonight are very confusing as to the reality of what the cost is going to be. Now, in most projects, when there's a little bit of fire connected with it, and you have pros and cons, and again, in most cases, the minority seems to be better organized. Now, I heard last week that there was a petition circling around.
I don't know of any petitions circling around for people who feel that this project is unnecessary. And if it's permissible, I'd like to know, and I'd like the group to know, what the heading is on the petition that had something like 400 names on it. Does it say, are you in favor of widening Shore Road, period? Without knowing what we now know from listening to all these people talk for almost 3 hours. When the government mandates money and hands you a big carrot, it's a one-time shot. Once they're finished with it, the cost of maintaining the work that was done goes on forever and ever and ever, and it's going to impact our property taxes. How many more projects can this town take on all at once? The town center, purchasing the Irving station next to the town hall, possibility, I hear, of buying more land on the other side of the town hall, a new rescue unit, which is funded by contributions, I agree, a new fire truck, a new maintenance truck with a plow. How many more projects financially can the town afford to take without having our taxes go sky high? So, is it permissible to ask what the heading was on that petition? Did it just say, would you vote for widening of the road without any explanation of how many feet on each side, how much land is going to be taken, how many walls are going to be destructed, how many trees are going to be cut down? On Two Lights Road, all the way down, it's all private property on the right, farmland. Someone's going to have to pay those people who own that land to chop off 10 feet. The same is going to be true of demolishing walls, cutting down birch trees on Shore Road that can never be replaced. Now, I've lived on Ivy Road 37 years. I'm retired. I'm very active in the town. I drive Shore Road 2 or 3 times a day. The road has more curves in it than any other road in Cape Elizabeth. We have other places for people to jog and bike. We have a beautiful Fort Williams. We have Route 77 that's wide. All I've heard for 37 years is we want Cape Elizabeth to be a nice rural town with beautiful trees, beautiful homes, beautiful school, everything. Fort Williams, don't let anybody go in there and build condos. Don't let anybody go in there with a couple of stores. Keep it nice, quiet, rural. We're willing to pay the few extra dollars to keep it that way. Now, all of a sudden, because there are a few, and I'm talking about the whole town, the greatest good for the greatest number. People have been up here talking, they're bikers, they're joggers. Fine. I'm a tennis player. I'm a golfer. Do I want the town to build an indoor tennis establishment because I'm a tennis player? No. There are many places in Cape to go to bike and jog without doing anything to Shore Road.
Excuse me, Frank.
Yeah.
You've had your 5 minutes.
Okay.
You will be able to cut it right off?
My arm is tired from asking you to speak, but I just want to mention that all the articles that have been in the newspaper about this project all have different monetary amounts attached to them. That's more confusion. One last thing, the parallel to this project is the crime bill, where the feds say, here's 75% of money to each town and city. You're going to put up 25% to hire 1, 2, or 3 policemen. A couple of months ago, there were articles in the paper. A lot of towns in Maine, and here it is right here, municipalities balk at grants to hire police.
Okay.
25%, excuse me, 25% is more than their whole annual budget in some of those small towns. Once the money is given, it's a one-time shot. From that point on, it's going to impact the tax rate in this town. And I think that that is expecting too much when doing anything to Shore Road. In other words, in my estimation, it's an unnecessary venture, period. Thank you very much.
Hey, thank you. There's a gentleman in the back there with a green sweater on, if I'm correct.
All members of the council, my name is Howard Littlefield. I live at 6 Lawson Road, which is on the corner of Shore Road and Lawson. I have two children. I've been a resident of the Cape for 17 years, and I've seen my neighborhood change from no children in our area to probably 7 or 8 and still growing and growing and as the character of the street changes. I don't ride on Shore Road with a bike. I've done it once to Fort Williams, and I never did it again. I've occasionally walk a little bit on Shore Road, but not very far, maybe to Pond Cove and back up around. And I'm always watching my backside for a car coming around the corners there to make sure I don't get run over. It is a little better since they put the water line in, because there's a little bit of about a 4-foot abutment. They've added gravel there that you can walk on now, which really makes a little bit of difference for walking anyway, but it's not very good for riding. As you go down around the curve the other way, the pavement drops off about 4 or 5 feet for the entrance to Byers Woods, which is very bad for biking. And you hit that and you're liable to take a spill. I'm definitely in favor of widening the road. If you take a look at what actually needs to be done, you measure from the edge of the white line 4 feet, and then you probably get another 2 or 3 feet of gravel that they would put on to hold the pavement. And you're going to have some drainage problems, but those should be taken care of. And I don't, in most places, the stone walls will not be affected that much. I think for the money spent, this will be well spent to make it easier to get to Fort Williams or the town center. I have neighbors that go both ways, and I don't see that when I drive up through the center to the town center every morning to go to work over in Scarborough, when I meet 5 or 6 joggers and I have to move off the side of the road towards the center every time, and you have to make sure there's not another car coming to do that, or you slow way down because it's dark and at 6:30 in the morning, and all these people are out jogging. And I really do think that you need to widen the road by 4 feet. Thank you.
Thank you. 8 feet. Somebody right here.
What? Please be polite.
Yes. Red sweater. Red.
I'll make it very short.
That's what we like to hear.
My name's Nick Burnett. I live at 19 Delano Park. I live on Shore Road. I'd be willing to give up some of my frontage, as it were, to make it a safer place, because we talk about quality of life. To me, it's important that if we're going to have a rural community, that people can walk along the streets, that people can ride bicycles, that they can jog if they want to. But that it's a place where people feel comfortable, and it's not just for cars. I think that safety enters into this. I have 2 children. We live next door to Fort Williams. One of my children uses a wheelchair. He can't get to the park because he can't safely get 2 streets over to the park. And my other son, I won't let him ride his bicycle either. But I think we should, if we live in a small community, feel like our families can go and live the way we want to live without worrying about dangers from cars. Thank you.
You're welcome. Yes, Mr. Roberts.
Mr. Chairman, members of the council, my name is Jack Roberts. I live at 185 Fowler Road, and it's about a mile from here, but I drove over tonight, and you wouldn't find me walking on our streets. The reason that I had several points I wanted to bring up, and most of them have been eloquently stated previously, but unfortunately, we're fighting the stereotype of what 77 looks like with the 8-foot wide bikeways and wide lanes to boot. Shore Road does not have to look like that. It can be rural. The upper portion of Shore Road, closer to South Portland, has the wider area with sidewalks, and it's a very pleasant area of town. The town, over the years, has been remiss in taking care of the shoulders and this, in the town. On my street, Christmas evening, I went over to deliver packages to a neighbor. A car was coming, I stepped off the side of the road, and I wore an ear cast for 2 days. You cannot step off the sides of the roads, whether it be Shore Road, Two Lights Road, Mitchell Road, or whatever. You need this area to walk or get out of the way of oncoming cars. Someone made the comment about people could walk on the green belts. Well, as we try to do that, we put in the green belts, then the neighbors come back and say, post no parking. They want the people walking there. They don't want them picking their cars. So there's that mentality. Yes, we can walk there, but we don't want you to be able to do it safely. Design can protect what Shore Road looks like, and that's why it's important to do this study, to do it right, and protect those things that we want to preserve. No matter how you vote on this issue, you can't do it because of votes, because, folks, it's a 50-50 split, be my guess. You've got to have to do it because it's right, and safety is one of those reasons to vote for this. People are getting home in the evening at 4:30 or 5 o'clock in the wintertime. They cannot go out and walk. It is already dark. There is no shoulder, and you cannot see where you're stepping. The town's removed the lights that may have helped us in the past. 4 feet is probably already there and just needs to be graded and put into condition that a person can walk on it. And that has been stated. And again, thank you. I appreciate your patience.
Lady here with the white. Thank you.
My name is Judy Klein, and I live on Bridle Path in Sherwood Forest. And I'm excited enough about this project that I went around and took the petition in my neighborhood and only found one person that wouldn't sign it. I'm raising my child here. I found more reasons than I even knew existed to do this. I'm very much in favor of it.
Thank you. This gentleman over here.
I'm Gary Beckwith. I live on Oakwood Road, which is not connected directly to Shore Road. Simply put, I'm in favor of going ahead with a plan on both roads. All the long speeches and all the things that have been covered, but I would like to cover just a couple of other points, if I may. I am a cyclist. I'm a retired, fixed income taxpayer of the city, also the town. I cycle all over the place, putting in a couple of thousand miles a year on my bicycle, but also a number of, for every mile that I cycle, there's five that I drive. And I go to the bakehouse every Tuesday because it's discount day on my bicycle, weather permitting. I go to Mill Creek or in town or the IGA, and I also ride a lot of miles to train for the senior games, which I like to be involved with. Because of that involvement, I became a member of the PACS Citizens Bicycle Pedestrian Advisory Committee, and we've completed a rather lengthy report. And out of that, I would like to address a couple of points. Speed. There are some measures that can reduce the speed. One of them is when you create the road width for the cars, you reduce it somewhat to keep it down 12 feet, perhaps a little bit less, depending on the posted speed, with that white line, and it keeps the speed modest for those people who will obey the speed limit anyway. The other speed-reducing thing is simply physical devices, like I read about in the paper the other day, speed tables, something like a modified speed bump that can be put into the pavement that slows down, posted, of course, and striped and so forth, but it will reduce the speed. I won't talk about the issues of safety. I think it's been well covered. I moved here as a adolescent with my folks in 1945. At that time, the population these are average figures, about 3,200 residents. In 1950s, when we purchased our house, my wife and I purchased our house, there were 3,800 some odd residents. The present time, the 1990 census has 8,854, and I don't really know what the count is of residents at this time. There are 3,200 households in the Cape at the present time. That's more households than there were people when I moved here, or about the same number of households. A reflection. Why do I ride a bicycle? Because I like to. I believe in it. It's a good exercise. Bicycling, incidentally, as a means of transportation, is by far the most energy-efficient means to go a mile that there is. Walking, jogging, and the most inefficient means to go a mile is the single-occupied automobile. I was reading an editorial in the paper last week about pollution and energy, and this has to be a part of it.
Excuse me, I don't know how long that article is or what have you, but...
I won't read the article,
but
I'll wind up with that.
You've had your 5 minutes, and so
I'd
appreciate it if you could cut it off.
I'll wind it up.
Okay.
In a generation, not only has the automobile increased, but each driver drives twice as much as they did a generation ago. I'm in favor of the proposal. Thank you.
Thank you. This young lady right here. She's a jogger, I can tell the way she's dressed.
My name's Andy Mitchell. I live on Smuggler's Cove Road, and I've been a jogger on Shore Road for 12 years. I've sprained my ankle on Shore Road twice and have had to jump off into the woods by Delano Parks numerous times to avoid cars. One of my good friends, Amy Bird, just had to jump off into the woods and hit her head on a tree last week because of a car that was coming up a hill beside Delano Park, and that roads were icy and they almost collided. And I'm sure many of you know that Cape Elizabeth has produced some incredibly outstanding athletes in the past. And as I stand here today, I see Mrs. McLaughlin, Nancy Greenlaw, and the Townsends were here, the Paciuses were here, and the Rileys are here. They all have children that have gone on to college and have played sports in college. And when I graduated in 1993, I had 85% of our graduating class and probably 90% of Cape Elizabeth High School participated in sports. And when I was on the cross-country team and the track team there, we weren't allowed to run on Shore Road. We were told to go in the woods or go on Route 77, but we weren't allowed to use Shore Road because our team couldn't fit on the shoulder on Shore Road. So I don't know much about taxes or federal grants, but I do know that my classmates and a lot of the students at Cape Elizabeth High School use Shore Road as a means for keeping in shape when they're in high school and when I come home from college and when all my friends come home from college. And I don't think that it's a private thing that we would be doing if we widened Shore Road by 4 feet. I think that there are many people who jog from Cape Elizabeth High School down around into Cranbrook and back up to the school. There's paths in through Cranbrook and the Robinsons land out there that you have to come out and jog back up on Shore Road back to the school. So I don't think this is a private part of the town that would be. When I was in school, I got together with all my friends after school, and we would go down to the fort and play tennis, or go down to Family Field and play softball or baseball. So it's not a part of the town that is solely going to be using this part of Shore Road. I think it's, speaking from my generation, I think it's a big part of Cape Elizabeth High School, Shore Road is.
Thank you.
So I am in favor of it.
This gentleman right over here with the jacket on.
Thank you for your attention. My name is Richard Mahoney. I live at 27 Fowler Road. My questions to you as counselors is the following. It's the safety issue of not simply the Shore Road that now exists, but the two new Shore Roads that you will create with a four-foot path. In other words, this is approximately 4 feet. Do you envision a bicyclist riding with traffic or against traffic?
With.
Do you envision a jogger, a runner, a walker of all ages running with the bicycle or against the bicycle?
Against.
With. With or against?
Against.
So you've created now two-way traffic on two new four-way streets called Shore Road. Now think a moment as counselors, the consideration. If a bicyclist is going this way and a jogger and a walker of different ages and different speeds are going the opposite, there is a great increase of having tremendous safety issues built within the 2 4-foot pathways. Leaving the road out, there will be different speeds on those 4 foot pathways. If they run the same way, a jogger or a walker cannot see a bicyclist approaching them. If they run opposite ways, you're creating, in essence, three bi-directional highways or roadways. And I ask you to consider those issues. I do not think 4 feet. I would not want to be walking with arthritis slowly and having a bicyclist come against me on different turns, even within that road. I think that's the heart of the safety issue. If it were 8 feet, it might be very different. Or if it were striped, where bicyclists would keep one side, joggers the other side. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
Hi, I'm Keith Citrin. Live on Seven Chambers Road. I grew up in Cape Elizabeth, and I've spent most of my life here. And I've bicycled extensively in Cape as a child, as an adult. And it was very, very dangerous bicycling on Shore Road when I was growing up here, and it's even more dangerous now. And I really urge you to really vote in favor of the bikeway. I really hope it doesn't take a serious fatality for us to do something about making Shore Road safe. Putting a bikeway on Shore Road is not going to destroy Shore Road and its beauty. It's just going to make it safer. And I don't think that putting a bikeway on Shore Road or Two Lights Road is necessarily going to raise our taxes. It's just a question of priorities. And I hope that the council is very proactive on doing bikeways. The town of Cape Elizabeth has been very proactive on issues for many years, and I hope it will continue to be. Thank you.
You're welcome. Nancy.
I'm Nancy Masterton. I live in Wildwood Drive, but for 32 years I lived at Delano Park, and I currently own a property in Delano Park that is on Shore Road with stone walls, and I am here to register my approval of your going ahead with the planning for the Shore Road pathway or bikeway, whatever you want to call it. When we moved here in 1962, my kids were 5 and 7, and Cape Elizabeth was not a recreation mecca. We didn't have the state parks. We didn't have Fort Williams. We didn't have the swimming pool. We kind of made our own fun in Delano Park, and the kids rode their bikes around the park and probably went out onto Shore Road. I don't remember asking them not to. And I never once, except on the first day of school, went up to the corner where the bus stopped with my kids, my little kids, to see them safely on the bus. But going down Shore Road, you see mothers with little kids waiting for the bus to come or picking them up afterwards. And I assume it is because they are not over-solicitous mothers, but that they consider Shore Road to be a dangerous road. I do want to remind the council also that in 1984, when I ran for council, one of my issues was a bicycle path on Shore Road. I sat right up there at a candidates meeting and put this forward, and we considered it every year when we did our budgeting. We all had to have goals. I don't know whether you do that now, but individually we each proposed goals for ourselves and for the council to accomplish over the next year in connection with budgeting. And this issue of Shore Road was always before me, and I always made sure it was before the rest of the council. And I think, Phyllis, you might have been in on that. Certainly you were, Bill. Janet. So, you know, this is not a flash in the pan. In the 80s, as our manager pointed out, we did have actions on this very issue. And we did go to PACT. Somebody spoke here as Mr. Beckwith, I believe, who was a representative on the advisory committee for PACT. We pushed it with PACs several years, and it finally went through. And it was only when the recession struck that the $100,000 that we had put aside for the path work was given over to another good cause. And it was after I left the council, I might add. So I feel that I should be here tonight. And with me, it was always a safety issue. I am frightened to think of that first fatality that is inevitably going to come on Shore Road. So I urge the council to go ahead with the planning. I like the idea of a committee, an advisory committee. I'd be happy to serve on that myself. I know Shore Road like the palm of my hand, and I'm sure that this work can be done creatively so that hopefully we can protect the lilac bushes, the trees, the rocks, and the stone walls. I'm sure it can be done. I think we have to think positively, so go for it, Council.
Thank you. Gentleman in the back in the plaid shirt.
Ed McElhinney, 981 Shore Road. I've been standing up for 3.5 hours. Maybe more people should have stood up for 3.5 hours. That way they wouldn't need to walk or ride on the road, but that's beside the point.
That's why I called you. I figured you stood long
enough. Thank you, Bill. 80% seems to be the number. 80% of the money comes from the government. 80% of the people at U Shore Road are from out of town. 80% of the people that spoke were from the Mitchell family. But getting off that track, anyways. Having living at 981, I'm right on the border from where it goes to the kind of the wide road to the narrow road. You took my trees down at the park next door and you never asked me. But why ride a bike to Fort Williams when you don't have a bike path in Fort Williams to ride on? I walk in the park every day with my children, and I can't cross the street because of the 15-mile-an-hour speed limit, and we can't go sliding because people go too damn fast. They go too fast on Shore Road. So I think safety is the biggest issue, but we need a bike path in Fort Williams so we can pedal there to get there. I think that we need to have a committee. I'd like to volunteer to be on that committee. I think that we can keep the aesthetics of the town beautiful, much like we did with Jonesy's awnings and Cumberland Farms awnings, so it looks like an old-fashioned town. But so in other words, I think there's a lot of people that we have like two standards. I think that we have to look at ourselves and slow down on Shore Road because you can't enjoy the beauty of Shore Road even at 35 miles an hour. We do need a bike path, and I think that we do need a bigger study. And like Mr. Mitchell said, 80% of the road doesn't need to be touched, so why is it $500,000 if all we have to do is clean up the side of it? But anyways, I'd be in favor of a study anyways, and I think that a study should be conducted, and it should be held with an input from the town as well as the town council. Thank you.
Thank you. Why don't you move down here, and then I'll get you a little later. There's a lady back there, the blonde lady. Oh, there she comes.
Thank you. My name is Marion Holzhauser, and I live on Two Lights Road near the State Park. I'm a senior citizen on a fixed income. I'm not a cyclist. I'm not a jogger, but I do enjoy walking, and I've given up walking on Two Lights Road. For one thing, the shoulders are very narrow. They're not very safe. We do have a hill there that is a blind hill, and I have to step well off of the road when I go up that hill. I have grown children who enjoy cycling, and I have grandchildren who enjoy cycling. The children, the grandchildren, are not allowed to cycle on Two Lights Road without their parents. I've heard the arguments against Two Lights Road. There is a nice section that is clear and simple for cyclists and pedestrians and joggers, but part of it is extremely dangerous. We do have out-of-town cyclists. There are cycling clubs that come down to the state park, and like Shore Road, we have our share of tour buses that take up the road, and the automotive traffic on Two Lights Road can be quite severe on nice days, whether it be summer or winter. And so I would strongly urge the council to at least go ahead with the design phase of this project. Thank you.
Yes, Peter.
Thank you. I'm Peter Leslie. I live at 15 Cragmore, and this reminds me a little bit of the 6 years I served on the school board, and if you go a little bit longer, I think you'll break our record, but you're getting there. Thank you for your service. Earlier on in the evening, I said, well, everybody has said everything there is to say, except not everybody said it. And but in that same time, I began adjusting my own remarks. And basically, I come down to the simple fact that that I'm a biker, my son's a biker, my wife sometimes rides a bike. And basically, we don't ride on Shore Road anymore because it isn't safe. We never let our son ride to school unless he went through the woods. When we come downtown, we usually go through the woods, although those paths are getting harder to find. But we can ride all the way to Exit 8 safely. We can ride to Portland, to South Portland. So to me, it's simply an issue of safety. That part of Shore Road that we're fortunate to live on, and just last night, my wife and I walked down to Fort Williams at 9 o'clock at night, and we turned around where the road got narrow. We feel cut off a little bit from the town center, but frankly, we don't feel sorry for ourselves because we live in a part of Shore Road which is attractive and safe. I feel sorry for those people who can't reach Fort Williams from the southern part of the town, the people that live along Shore Road that can't get to the school or can't get down to Two Lights or the southern part of the Crescent Beach. So I think we have a highly used road which is unsafe for bikers. I'm sure it's equally unsafe, as we've heard tonight, for joggers, for walkers. And as so many speakers have urged you tonight, at least take a look at the design. At least take that additional step to see if we can get the safety on Shore Road that we need and preserve its unique aesthetics. Thank you.
Thank you. Gentleman back there, way back. There we come.
My name is Michael Meehan. I live on 69 Two Lights Road, and I'm in favor of a bike path. I do remember, I've been on Two Lights Road for 11 and a half years, and I do remember that fatality. Let's not have another one. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Mr. Chairman, I believe there's a council rule that we stop at 11 o'clock, and I would hate to have us get caught in a technicality.
I believe we can handle one more.
I think we can, but if the clerk can
yes.
Tell me if we have to do something.
Gentleman back there with the blue sweater, white shirt. I know who it is now. I didn't before he stood up.
Oh, jeez. I guess that's it. We're done.
Yeah, we're done.
I'm Steve Monahan, and I live at 40 Surf Road. Several things. First, I love riding on Shore Road, and I personally don't ever feel unsafe riding on Shore Road. When I was working, I'd come home at night and set my speed control and sit back and relax all the way home. Truthfully, I said it at the Petros. Secondly, I am a jogger and also a runner, and I run on Shore Road all winter, 3 days a week, rain or shine. And fourthly, it seems to me that the safety is a serious problem, but everyone seems to be more concerned about Shore Road being unsafe than elsewhere in town. Anytime you pick up the Cape Courier, for every time there's an accident or an incident on Shore Road, there are 10 cars hit by deer someplace else in the town. So I don't, and statistically, it's potentially a very, very dangerous road, but to my knowledge, it doesn't seem as though that an inordinate number of accidents there. And finally, it isn't the fact that this is going to cost $118,000. I think it, in my own inactivity politically in this town, it has been changed by the school $19 million assessment. And every time something like this comes up, I'm going to be aware of it from here on in. And I think that $118,000 is just a drop in the bucket, basically. But it's going to be another $118,000 and another $200,000. And then this high school is going to have to be remedied. And they have to take a stand at some point. And I think it's time that many of us feel that this is where we're taking a stand. And I think it's a good reason to do it, because it's something we can very well get along without.
Thank you. Just a minute. We got a little house rules that we got to take care of, because it's 11 o'clock and we got to have a motion to move on beyond 11 o'clock.
Mr. Chairman,
how many more?
I move that we suspend the rules.
Second.
Moved and seconded that we suspend the rules and move on.
Mr. Chairman, I think we ought to find out how many more people there are. I keep seeing new hands popping up, and we'll be here suspending rules at 12 o'clock the way we're going.
Well, I'll find that out after we vote on the motion. Yeah. Everyone understand the motion? All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed? How many more speakers we have, really serious ones? See, one, two, three. Okay, we'll move on. Mr. Adams.
I am, just for the count, I don't know whether Deborah's been keeping it, but I'm number 62. My name is Henry Adams. I live at Todd Road, which is a tributary to Shore Road, right by Alan Elkins' stockade fence. And if we increase the speed on Shore Road anymore, I'm going to have to witness some more of the traumatic experiences when he comes out to survey the damage. I told him once that he ought to go see a psychiatrist. I had a long speech. I'm going to shut it down. But I have listed, and on this piece of paper, I have listed a great many things in this town that need doing. We need lights down at the school that don't work. We need a fuel tank that's got to be replaced. The ladies' locker room is cold, not from personal experience, but Nancy will attest to that. Nancy will attest to that. And so will Louise Merrill. We've got to remodel the town hall for ADA. We've got to put money into Fort Williams for toilets. The former chairman of the council in his inaugural address said that that was one of his objectives. We've got to get rid of those despicable, disgusting portable toilets so that the tourists will feel welcome. The thing that bothers me tonight is that everything is being shaped and people are instilling a sense of absolute fear on Shore Road. And I wish that the council would take that into consideration, that's the impetus tonight. And it's bikers and joggers. But we've got more places in this town that need attention. To spend $500,000 now on Shore Road and destroy its beauty, to spend that money on Two Lights Road, I think would be criminal. And by the time we get ready to do it, it's going to be, you know as well as I do, it's going to be $600,000 to $700,000. And as Jim Crocker says, the local Daily News back on December 28th said, and I, first paragraph, Maine has the fourth highest state and local tax burden in the country, according to the Money Magazine's sixth annual survey. And then you take a look at the paper, of January 5th, and you read one little paragraph, and it scares me to death. Quote, there has not been a municipality which has said no to one of these federal grants, said Bill Pulver, a state engineer who ensures that town projects comply with federal standards. That scares me to death. It's like, you know, you don't look a Greek, you know, this is, beware of Greeks bearing gifts. Watch it. I didn't want to get into the old nag, but you know.
I thought you didn't have a humorous quote.
What?
I thought you said you didn't have a humorous.
I do, and if you want to spend money for the bike paths, if you want to do all of that business, all well and good. But then, if you all had the opportunity of picking up Saturday's paper, on the front page, there's the smiling countenance of Jeffrey Darrell. Cable, customers to pay more, and the change over to fiber optics. We're going to be paying more for everything we have in this town, and I think Steve Monahan hit it right on the head. Somewhere we got to draw the line, and why don't we draw it now? We're paying heavily for that school right there, and I think the taxpayers of Cape Elizabeth have said enough is enough. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Gentleman right down here. You're next, Mr. Barry.
Oh, good evening, members of the town council. My name is Fred Poulin. I live at 58 Two Lights Road. And since I've been watching our Congress on TV a lot lately, I want to say that I rise in support of the bike path and pedestrian path of Two Lights Road. I live on the section of the road that where a path would be built, and my house is also close to the road. I have a fence, I have two stone pillars, I have a couple of dozen rose bushes, all of which are very close to the right-of-way. As far as I'm concerned, you can build a 4-foot path, you can build a 10-foot path, you can build path on both sides of the road, one side or the other. You can build a path that's off the side of the road. You can pave my front yard if you'd like to, but it's that important to me. I think that this ultimately will enhance the value of the properties on Two Lights Road to have a pedestrian and bike path. And I think the concern that may exist among some citizens that their property values will be diminished is not correct. Now, why do I think this will enhance the value of my property? I think you've heard the issues over and over again, but I want to also defend my right to be redundant here. I think that the Two Lights Road section has received perhaps a little short shrift here because of the concern about Shore Road. And I hope that's just because it's so obvious that a bike path is that much more justified on Two Lights Road than it is on Shore Road. Safety is the overwhelming concern. And I just want to say a few things about Two Lights Road that have not come up that need to be said. I've lived there for 10 years, and I've observed this firsthand. First of all, we're not inviting there to be more activity on this road than there already is. There is a tremendous amount of activity already. Just to go down the road, we have an antique shop, we have the Lions Club, we have the pick-your-own strawberry fields, we have another antique furniture store, we have a new lobster establishment on the road. We then have the two state parks, we have the two lighthouses, we have a fishing rod and golf club repair shop, we have a popular restaurant, we have several craft shops. This is a bustling road. There is a lot of traffic already there. It's become increasingly more popular with pedestrians and cyclists in the last 10 years. Now, the place is not safe. I have spent a lot of time walking, riding, pushing strollers, trying to guide kids on bicycles on this road. And I can tell you that I cannot wait to get around the corner out onto Route 77, where the traffic most of the time is 40 to 45 miles an hour, pretty much the same as what it is on Two Lights Road. And yet that few feet of extra pavement that you have to walk in, to ride on, whatever, the feeling of safety is there when it is simply not there on Two Lights Road. Now, I agree that you can sometimes ride and walk safely on Two Lights Road, perhaps a dry day in August. But at this time of the year, or when the ground is wet, the shoulders are soft, they don't support pedestrians. I find it paradoxical that the people that oppose the bike path do so on the same grounds that I would use to support it, which is to enhance the rural quality and the neighborhood aspects. What is rural? Is it seeing people out using the road as pedestrians, or is it preventing them from doing so because of traffic? What is safe? Is it people and bikes sharing the same pavement with cars, or is it they're having a little bit of extra pavement? What is a neighborhood? Is it a place where people can walk to their neighbor's house safely, or is it a place where your kids grow up thinking that they have to get in a car to go a few hundred yards down the road to visit their friends? I think having a bike and pedestrian path enhances the rural quality of a neighborhood and enhances the neighborhood quality. So I urge you to support this for Two Lights Road. I also support the path on Shore Road because I drive there and find it unsafe as a driver. I just want to say I think this is a difficult issue because there seems to be a polarity here, which unfortunately seems to be between older citizens and younger citizens in this town. And I'm not quite sure what's the best way for the council to deal with that. I do know that I heard that we were willing to spend money to send refrigerator magnets to everybody in town that would tell them about the new dump hours. I think we might be able to afford the postage to send a referendum to members of the town describing a little more accurately what would be planned with these two paths and finding out how the populace feel as a whole. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Mr. Barry, I promise you could be next.
Thank you, Mr. My name is Henry Berry, and I live on Two Lights Road, and there is a lot of traffic there, one of the reasons being that a non-conforming use was allowed to expand greatly, and there is a lot of traffic that causes a dangerous situation. We don't allow our dogs to go out on the Two Lights Road because they'll get hit, let alone children. Two children have been seriously injured and one killed on the Two Lights Road. However, I am concerned about the physical layout of this wide path. The Two Lights Road itself, the blacktop part of Two Lights Road, is not very wide. And if it were to be expanded according to the plan that I've heard tonight, then my own property would be decimated. My home is protected by a row of trees that gives us protection from the wind off the ocean in the winter, which is very severe about 10 weeks out of the year in that part of the Two Lights Road. I think where Dr. Sullivan's house is and where Mrs. Jordan's house is along there certainly doesn't need any stripes along the road or any widening. Where the strawberry fields are there, there's plenty of room to walk if they want to. I see people walking by, and I myself walk out there. I know that the traffic does go too fast, but that's up to the police. That's not going to be changed by painting stripes down the road or putting another shoulder or something. That's up to the police to set up the radar up toward the state park and stop a few people. And just as the previous speaker said, over at Black Point Road in Scarborough, where they've put the 25-mile-an-hour zone and sit on it, I think they produce a lot of revenue for the state over there, and they don't go very fast. I know on the right-hand side of the Two Lights Road, there is the state park property, or a state-owned property, the conservation area, the wilderness area, whatever they call it, the conservation area, and that is across from Hannaford Cove Road. It's too bad, I think, that the Shore Road and the Two Lights Road have been joined in this presentation, because I think they're two entirely different places. The Shore Road has more curves than Merriam Monroe, and this Mitchell Road area is very curvaceous, and the Two Lights Road up to where the gentleman has described this hill near the state park is straight away, except for a slight curve by Dr. Sullivan's house. But from the beginning of the Two Lights Road all the way down beyond my house is straight away. And I think that's a very different characteristic than the Shore Road. And I think they should be considered separately. I don't think there's a need for a path there if there is some enforcement for the speed. That's what takes care of speeders, is knowing that that cop is going to be there handing him a $150 ticket. That will slow him down very quickly, and the word will get around. I am very concerned about widening the road in that portion of Two Lights Road, which is at the intersection of Hannaford Cove Road, because on one side, Mr. Griffin's property and the Lane property there, from Fessenden Road up on that side, that would take their front yard. If they come over on my side, they're going to have to move the wires, the telephone poles, the hydrants, the underground, and they're going to have to decimate my property by taking out 50-year-old trees that are 40 feet high, and it will leave my home open to the blast across that open field off the ocean. I think that's a geographical consideration that has to be addressed separately, and I think any plan that is done, if you're going to do a plan, I don't think there's any need for the thing. I oppose the bike path. I think that most of these automobile accidents are due to the person behind the wheel of the car. I think that's where most of the accidents happen, and if they were convinced that they should slow down or it's going to be very expensive, then that would take care of a lot of it. I can understand the Shore Road curving all the way up, excuse me, up toward the Fort Williams area going both ways, but Two Lights Road is not like that, and I think that Shore Road should be considered separately from the Two Lights Road and not linked together. I wonder why Mitchell Road was not included in this consideration. I don't know how this came to be. I don't know. But Mitchell Road has been mentioned tonight as one of the major thoroughfares with a lot of curves and a lot of development going through the town. Why not there? Why don't you have stripes up there? The Two Lights Road is very straight. There are other roads in the town, and all the people there, there is some financial consideration. I don't think that's the dominant one, except for perhaps some of the people on fixed incomes who have spoken tonight. But if some accountant can come up with 80 cents apiece, then I don't think that's going to be hurting very much. The safety consideration and certainly the protection for the people is much more valuable than a few dollars. But I am very concerned about that area of Two Lights Road that will be decimated if the bike paths are put there. I hope you'll give that your consideration if you consider to study this. I don't think it's necessary. I think it's a waste of money. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Yes. Oh, just a minute, Steve. Okay,
thank you,
Peter,
Mr. Chair.
Go ahead.
I'll be brief. My name is Peter Rich. I live on Smuggler's Cove Road. I'm in favor of the study. I'm in favor of the things that were outlined on the petition that was presented to you that has 425 signatures of residents of the town that would encourage the town, would ask that the town council proceed with the MDOT study. That would advise MDOT that the town's is concerned about stone walls, is concerned about environmental issues, and is concerned about shrubbery and trees along the roads. And that the town's final acceptance of the plan is contingent upon those issues being satisfied, and the creation of a committee to work with MDOT to ensure that this takes place, and that the committee includes all those interests that have been spoken to tonight. And on the basis of that, 425 residents signed your petition. Thank you.
Thank you. Steve.
I'm Steve Simons. Live on Brentwood Road, Cape Elizabeth. I'll make four very brief points. One is I wanted to be included among those three or four former councillors who were in favor of this proposal. Also wanted to correct a couple of perhaps misimpressions you may have from some of the former speakers. We do live in another part of town, in the Brentwood section. It's across town. And this proposal means a great deal to Judy and myself. We have a couple of bicycles, which we'd love to take down Shore Road. Neither one of us would dare to do that. It certainly would, we believe, shorten our life when bicycling is supposed to be extending your life. Also, on the question of cost, and maybe Mike can answer this, isn't this the first time that we have had substantial monies made available for this kind of a project?
No. The Route 77 bikeway that was done years ago was predominantly federally funded.
Well, in any event, these are monies that we have already paid for through taxes, federal, state, local. Having watched the process in Augusta, and seen time after time funds being allocated to other jurisdictions and municipalities, Cape usually at the end of the line, I would like for once to see those funds come for a legitimate and necessary purpose for this town. Also, I think that we've heard comments from both sides of this issue, legitimate concerns on all sides. I think that the matter can be resolved through some study and through the design process. We've seen indications of this in other municipalities in the state, very divisive issues that have been handled in a dispute resolution kind of format, and I think Cape is capable of doing the same on this issue. And if Henry Adams would agree to be number 79 on the committee, I'll be number 80. And I suspect that we could find a creative solution, and I urge you to go forward with the design. Thanks.
Thank you. Anybody else? Yes.
I know I spoke one
at a time. Oh, well, wait and see if we have a first speaker first.
And we've got a couple.
Anybody else care to speak? I'll give you 2 minutes.
1 minute.
Thank you.
Rebecca Bartlett from Broad Cove Road. I just had to
say one more thing that I forgot to last time. I hope that you really sincerely listen to Andrea Mitchell, because that was the other issue I wanted to speak on. I think we all know the serious problem we have in our school with teenage drug and alcohol use. It's not just CAPE, it's other places too. But we've been looking through schools and school system and parents to find a way to help these kids get off drugs and alcohol. CAPE Coalition, whom I'm a member of, is trying to find a way to come to the community and to you to help see if you can help us find a way to support these kids in a way to keep them off drugs and alcohol. And I think Andrea said something very, very important. When asked several of these kids, why, you know, do you drink? Why do you take drugs? And they say, what else do you do in Cape Elizabeth? She, you know, Andrea just told you what kids can do. Maybe if there was access to these places where kids can hang out appropriately and safely, more kids would. I really believe that they would. I know that some would. I hope that you give it serious consideration. These are the kids, the future of your town, and believe me, they keep coming back. We need to think about them too. The teenagers haven't had much word here tonight, and I'd like to just add that last thought to think of that group of kids too. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else? Therefore, we'll cut off the public hearing and move on to the item, which is item 88, to consider authorizing the design of a bikeway shoulder along Shore Road in Fort Williams Park to Route 77, taking necessary action.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
I'd move that we pass the draft motion, item 88, as the town manager has drafted for us. Would you like me to read it?
You want to read it? Read part of it anyway. Go ahead.
All right. To authorize the town manager to notify the Maine Department of Transportation of the town's desire to move forward with the design of a bikeway pedestrian shoulder on Shore Road from Fort Williams Park to Route 77, subject to the following guidelines. 1. The shoulders may not exceed 4 feet in width on either side. 2. The bikeway may be narrower at Pond Cove to avoid wetland filling. 3. Stone walls shall be relocated as a project expense if in the way of the project. 4. Design is to be completed by a firm hired by the town of Cape Elizabeth. 5. A local design review committee consisting of 7 citizens with the town manager and the director of public works serving as ex officio members shall be appointed by the town council to work with a consultant. 6. A final design shall be approved by the Cape Elizabeth Town Council. 7. This project shall be coordinated with a local project to improve drainage near Tides Edge Road. No design work may incur until October 1995 and no construction until the 1997 construction season. 9. No taking of private property. 10. Proper drainage patterns and snow storage area shall be maintained.
Second.
You heard the motion. Anybody got any comments? One way or the other. Yes, Councilor Dalbert.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. By the way, for Penny Carson's sake, I'm one of the people who have been opposed, and I think most everybody who's read the paper knows that. So just want to make sure that you're up to date, Penny. As I understand this, and I would like to be corrected by the town manager, what we are voting on is something that we only have a yes or no relative to a bikeway that follows the federal specifications. We have heard a lot of talk here today about alternatives, and some of that I think entices me. Well, I too would wonder, you know, what the alternatives might be. But I think this says we will have a bikeway that meets the federal specifications. And I'm using my words now and asking if this is right, which include a minimum of 4 feet on either side of the road.
Correct.
So we are not voting for a committee to get together and come up with some alternative approach.
As I understand the federal guidelines and as explained to me by MDOT, is they want to see it a minimum of 4 feet on the other side. If there's unique circumstances or characteristics, they're willing to talk about it. But your basic premise is correct that they do want you to follow the 4 feet on either side guideline. But they did indicate an openness to be willing to look if there was really something unique that worked with us.
Have you got any further definition of what something quote unquote unique might be, and or a curvy road like Shore Road, would they be more likely to go in places for 5 feet? Do you know that?
I'm not sure I understood your question. It's getting late. They indicated a willingness very much to work with the community within the desires of the community. However, they are going to be looking very strongly at those federal guidelines, and if there's going to be a diminution of those at any point, this would need to be a very good reason for doing so.
Okay.
Does that help?
Not much.
A little bit.
Good.
I am not going to be changing. There's been a lot of great discussion here today, and I'm just overwhelmed by the number of people. And the fact that there's still a large number who are here at this, I shouldn't have looked, hour. I am concerned about something that, as I read the comprehensive plan, is contrary, what has been proposed, contrary to what is in the comprehensive plan, which specifically mentions Shore Road. States quite specifically that the character would be greatly harmed if street widening or straightening were to occur. I could go and consider what some of the alternatives might be, but I am against that from a character standpoint. I am also concerned from a fiscal standpoint. I think it's been put well by a number of people. I realize that the town council and the town manager can always scrape up $80,000, and that's typically or $100,000 or $110,000, whatever the end figure is. That's typically done by delaying some project, whether it's another road that needs paving or a piece of equipment that needs buying. We have a school project which has been mentioned here tonight. I don't think we would have had a project of that magnitude had we not delayed a lot of very necessary work on those school buildings over the years. And by the time we got around to it, we ended up with a very expensive project on our hand. My fiscal comment not only pertains to bikeways, I just think we are at a point where we have to take a look at our overall town priorities, focus on them, and narrow down our spending. If we don't, I think we're begging for the tax cap that is being circulated, and I don't think any of us who understand the implication, the potential implication of that tax cap, is very anxious to see that happen. So while I am, I've heard a lot, while I can almost get to the point of saying, I really think I ought to go along with that, and in the end, I'm staying with my guns, I guess I would say, and voting against it.
Mr. Chairman.
Council Chappell.
Being one of the older people that's referred to by a few in the audience, I don't feel that way. I've had three children, as most of you know, brought up here, and we've had bikes and we've had carts and lived here for 38 years. If they would take this thing and throw that motion that my good friend Mr. Linnell brought up, and said that I would compromise this whole thing. I've done that all my life, seems so. I'm not for these for a fiscal reason, for a safety reason, for the other jobs that we have in the town to do. I've got my list of 15 here. I'm not going to bother you. It's too late, but they're massive. They sound easy, you know, by taking one job and putting it off for 2 years so that you can do this one here, and that's a mistake. It's only going to catch up with you. So I'm not for it, but I would compromise this whole thing to allow the study. But I'll be darned if I'm going to vote for the two bikeways with no figure that I'm sure of in front of me to look at, and how much land it's going to take, how many trees it's going to take, how many rock walls. I've got three different opinions on it. Which one am I going to take as the gospel truth? I think a study would show us exactly what we're up against, and then I could sit here as your counselor and do what you want me to do. But I can't do it without a plan. Just think of us going into an $18 million school without a plan and okaying it on a vote. You wouldn't do it. You'd shoot me. And I don't think you should ask any counselor to do that tonight or any other night without a definite plan and a definite cost. What this thing is going to cost us and how we're going to handle it. Mr. McGovern's done a nice job. He's put it ahead. But I don't like the two little things in there. Something else has to suffer. Right in his recommendation to us, something else has to suffer. And I don't like the other part. It should not increase the taxes. Tell me that it will not. Never mind this should not, and I'd be much happier. So I can't vote for the motion as it's read. I want you to know why. But I would compromise and let us all have, which I think we deserve, and that's the study. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Thanks. Councilor Nell.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. First, I'd like to say that I'm real pleased with the quality of the discussion from the citizens tonight, and I've never been to such a barn burner that was so polite. And my remarks are geared, although we're considering Shore Road at the moment, for brevity, my remarks are intended also for Two Lights Road. I think both tonight we've heard that both sides have essentially agreed, I think, that these roads aren't safe. And we're not imagining that. One thing that hasn't been brought up is what's called the critical rate factor, and I called PAX, which called the DOT, and I have a printout here from the DOT, and the critical rate factor is it's a number which the DOT arrives at considering various factors like accidents and whatnot, and they have a formula that they work with, and they come up with a certain number. And I want to talk a little bit about Mitchell Road. When we were talking about the Mitchell Road speed limit, you may recall the DOT didn't get that excited about lowering the speed limit on Mitchell Road. And one reason they pointed to was they said, well, the critical rate factor, I think, was 0.7. And when the critical rate factor gets to 1.0 or more, the DOT says, you know, we should look into this. We ought to do something. This is the, if it's an intersection or a stretch of road. And the printout that I just received Friday, I had talked to him about it, but I said I want it in writing.